worked in a number of areas of Catalysis, several of which we have worked in here also, dehydrocyclization, fissiotropes, and only recently did I learn in sulfated zirconia when I got a copy of the patent, and so he will be talking to us today about the acidic characteristics of sulfated zirconia.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you for arranging it on fairly short notice. I understand the reason for the announcement in the PA is that there wasn't any time to do anything else on this. Okay, this is a pleasure to be here. The subject that I'm going to talk about is one that we have been involved in for a couple of years, and the reason no one knew about it was because until most of the patents began to be filed and issued, we couldn't really talk about it. The first of two or three patents is the one that Kurt Davis just talked about, has come out. So we're now being cleared to talk about some of the work. This is the first official presentation of this work, but not the first unofficial one, because it turns out yesterday I was at Ashland Petroleum, and they said, oh, you're working on sulfated zirconia we didn't know anything about. Could you tell us a little bit about it? So I pulled out my Viewgrass and gave my third talk of the day yesterday. So I gave them a dry run on sulfated zirconia, and apparently they're also very interested in the area. Well, sulfated zirconia, we'll go through some of the historical background, and then I realized on the way here I was missing a couple of Viewgrass, so I need to go to the board in a little while and give you some of the preparation. I'm going to be right in front of you. First of all, let me acknowledge my co-authors. Stu Solik is a materials person that has done most of the synthesis and a good bit of the characterization of the materials I'm going to talk about. And George Kramer, which is an old-timer in the area of acid chemistry, was a person that brought to us adamantium compounds as hydride transfer agents, something that we knew very little about, and he had previously applied some sulfuric acid alkylation work, where also it works very effectively as a hydride transfer agent. What I'm going to talk about is alkane isomerization on sulfated zirconias, but I'm also going to tell you that without the promotion that we introduced by putting platinum in the system, and without the introduction of some hydride transfer species, which could take the form of either H2, adamantium groups, or another alkene, we're unable to get very rapid turnovers of sulfated zirconia. In spite of reports in the literature that you can isomerize alkenes directly on unpromoted sulfated zirconia, we have not been able to get more than single turnovers on any of these materials, so we apparently require the presence of some promoters on that surface in order to do this chemistry. So obviously this is not going to be exclusively an acid catalyzed reaction, because otherwise a material as acidic as sulfated zirconia ought to be able to do this kind of chemistry, and yet it does not. Well, from a motivational perspective, I think that there is a strong need to look at materials that can replace some of the halogenated acids and some of the liquid acids in most of this acid chemistry, mostly for environmental reasons. And certainly if you look at what is done today in the area of alkane isomerization, you find out that if you really want to do deep isomerization of alkanes, you do it at fairly low temperatures, and the only materials that seem to work at those temperatures are the so-called Friedel-Crafts type materials. Aluminum chloride either supported is maybe a loose term for it because it is not very strongly supported and tends to leach out of the catalyst, or in the liquid phase in the presence of HCl, co-promoters is actually a very active and selective material for alkane isomerization, and it does it very close to room temperature. And as a result, the thermodynamics of the isomerization would favor the di-branch and the tri-branch isomers in these molecules, which are the molecules that, to some extent, we are after, because we're in the petroleum business and we would like to get isomeric gasolines. In order to do that, you have to put several branches one back. The problem is that these materials are obviously toxic, they're air sensitive, and they're corrosive, and we would like to replace them with more stable solid oxides as heterogeneous acids. Now, there is an alternative, and the alternative generally takes the form of aluminum silicates, whether it be microporous, zeolitic type materials, or amorphous silica alumina. Those materials also do isomerization. However, the selectivity to isomers is quite low because they generally tend to operate at higher temperatures. They're not very active materials. They deactivate, and because of the higher temperatures, the dimethyl isomer selectivities are quite low. What is it that we need from our perspective, besides the fact that we need to immobilize these acids and make them non-corrosive, non-toxic, and in a form that can be contained within a catalytic reactor? What we also need is to be able to reproduce some of the features of these kinds of materials in solid oxides. What we need is to lower the temperature at which we do it in order to be able to get this kind of molecules, which are the ones that we really need. And most especially, I think, if you ever want to do isomerization of C7 plus paraffins, the problem that you find is that there is extremely high probability that you will crack that molecule. You have so many opportunities and so many carbon-carbon bonds, so many stable carbenium ions, that you end up with extremely high cracking selectivity, especially as you increase the conversion. The materials have been around for a long time, and I've decided to make a point here by listing also only a certain group of people that have worked in the area. But first of all, something that is usually forgotten, I think, is that the earlier work was actually done in the U.S., and it was done back in 1962, where sulfate-modified metal oxides were actually introduced phenomenologically without much understanding as to what really made them a strong acid by Holm and Bailey, I believe at Sun, but I'm not absolutely sure. But as far as 1962, these materials were known as being very strong acids, and yet most of the work in this area only began in the 1980s, and most of it, and that's why I chose this group of people here, they're all from Japan. And that is where most of the work on these materials was really done until about 2 or 3 years ago, when we began to do some work, I think, in the U.S. I may be excluding some people that actually did it before then, but I wanted to make the point that in this area, both in the sulfate of zirconia and to some extent in the heteropolyacid area, the Japanese have had a very strong research effort for many, many years. I don't know what happened between 62 and 1980, other than there are a few scattered papers, but not very strong directed research towards improving or understanding these materials. Now, some of this research has actually reported that at room temperature you can get some smaller alkanes to isomerize. This was highly dependent on the way the materials were prepared, and again, I repeat, in our hands, we're unable to do this kind of isomerization for any more than one turnover. In some cases, their work suggests that they can do it for a few turnovers, but these materials deactivate rather rapidly. They can't be regenerated, but they don't seem catalytic in the long term, at least. Now, they also catalyze all other reactions that are more typical of acid-catalyzed reactions, alkylation, oligomerization, dehydration-type reactions. The difference between these two types of chemistry is that here, in general, you don't need to abstract a hydrogen from a molecule in order to activate it, but if you insist on starting with a paraffin, you will have to activate that carbon-hydrogen bond in order to form the first carbocation. So there's something that these materials, in my view, are missing, and it's the ability to activate that paraffin by abstracting that initial hydride species. The next controversy is actually whether these are Lewis acids or they're Brønsted acids. And it turns out that if you look at a pristine material right after you made it, and you look at some of the pyridine adsorption studies that people have done, you can convince yourself that both types of sides are actually present on that surface. And yet, when you look at the kind of chemistry that you do here, the kind of chemistry is only reminiscent of Brønsted acid chemistry. It's a protonation type reaction. It's a carbocation. It's not Lewis acid chemistry. It's not metathesis type reaction, which is what you expect from Lewis acid. The fact is that if you look at a calcined and dehydrated material, you'll be hard-pressed to find any protons. And of course, you'll be hard-pressed to identify any Brønsted acid sites. But if you treat the material in hydrogen, especially in the presence of a hydrogen dissociation catalyst, such as platinum, or so I will tell you later, probably platinum sulfide, then you can begin to think about how you can generate those protons and stabilize hydrated type species on that platinum. And indeed, some of the Japanese workers, the group of Hattori, has actually looked at the generation of some of these protons, but not in the starting material, only in a material that has been treated in hydrogen in order to generate those protons. This again illustrates, I think, the importance of looking these materials in situ, because the hydrocarbons themselves are able to generate those protons, and as a result of it, convert what normally would be fairly strong Lewis acid sites in the material actually into a proton donating species, which is reminiscent of sulfuric acid, which is a fairly strong acid. Well, before I go and tell you a little bit about the catalytic data, which is the main purpose of my talk today, what I would like to do is I would like to tell you a little bit about the preparation of the materials. And these are the two slides that I have to miss. And the reason I want to do that is because a great number of people, including ourselves, have had some great difficulties, I think, trying to make materials that are active. And it took us about a year or so to actually come up with what today we feel is a good way of making many of these materials. You tell me if it looks better with that on or not. What do you think? Leave it on? Okay, how you generally make these materials is you take zirconium nitrate and you use a base. In our case, we use ammonium hydroxide at very high concentrations, and we precipitate a zirconium hydroxide species. And I will put X here because at this point, this is a very amorphous material, which is difficult to identify by X-ray diffraction, so we can't really assign any phase or structure to this kind of material. The next thing that we do is we dry this material at fairly low temperature, and before we dehydrate it to zirconium oxide, we actually exchange the material with platinum. Now, this is somewhat unusual. Most people would put the sulfate groups on the zirconium hydroxide at this point. We found this is a better way to do it. You put the platinum and you do it by ion exchange using chloroplatinic acid. And at this point, you dry the sample, you calcine it at fairly low temperatures, about 300 degrees Celsius, and then you impregnate with sulfuric acid. And we found that you can get variations in activity and in sulfur content by going to 1 normal to 5 normal sulfuric acid. But we have settled on this material because we feel that the additional sulfur that we introduce going to higher concentrations is not really significantly increasing the concentration of sulfate groups on that surface. At this point, we do something fairly dumb, which is to calcine this sample at fairly high temperatures. And we calcine this sample at 773 Kelvin. That's fairly high for a supported platinum particle, and we were sure that we were going to sinter this platinum to very large particles. Platinum does not like to be oxidized at these temperatures, and we did this for 4 hours. The sample that we actually ended up making, and the one I'm going to talk about, had 0.4% platinum by weight. It has 4.5% sulfate groups also by weight. Now, to give you some perspective, this material, after we have finished this calcination, has about 110 meters squared per gram. If I calculate the number of sulfur groups that I have, if all of them were on the surface, and I say something about what I think the concentration of oxygen atoms may be on that zirconium surface, my conclusion is that the coverage of sulfate groups on that surface is about 25% of a monolayer. So you can think of this surface as a zirconium oxide surface. 25% of that surface is covered by sulfate groups. Of course, each one of the sulfate groups is fairly large, and 25% is actually a fairly high coverage. We don't think that the additional sulfur that you actually put on the system by going to higher concentrations of sulfuric acid really increases that concentration significantly, and actually in many cases it adds additional sulfate groups on top that will restrict access to the ones that are really connected to the sulfate of zirconium. Now, we thought we were right because when we took this catalyst and we did a chemisorption experiment and we measured the hydrogen chemisorption ability of this material, we came up with a hydrogen to platinum ratio of 0.01. That would correspond to huge platinum particles of the order of 500 to 1,000 angstroms. And yet, when we look at the sample by transmission electron microscopy, what we find instead is that these particles are 40 to 50 angstroms. Now, why would platinum not chemisorb hydrogen if it has a fairly high dispersion? These numbers would give you something of the order of 0.3 for the ratio of hydrogen to platinum, and yet we only come up with 0.01. And the most likely reason is that we don't have platinum exposed on the surface, but we have sulfur-contaminated platinum. And we have sulfur-contaminated platinum regardless of whether we put the platinum here or we put the platinum after the sulfate. The results are really the same. Why else do we think that we have sulfide at platinum? We cannot do on this catalyst either hydrogenolysis of ethane or, for that matter, hydrogenation of ethylene. And those are two classical reactions that you can do on platinum, but you cannot do on sulfate or sulfur modified type platinum. So the problem with the platinum activity of these materials is not that you have poorly dispersed platinum, but rather that the platinum is going to be poisoned to some extent by the fact that you have a huge amount of sulfur in this system. Fortunately, platinum sulfide can still do some things. And one of the things that it can't do is hydrogen-deuterium exchange. One of the things that it can't do is dissociate H2 to H atoms. The problem that platinum sulfide has is it doesn't have a very high binding energy for that hydrogen atom, and as a result of it, we cannot get any strong chemisorption. But as I will show you later, we think that we can get dissociation of hydrogen on that sulfated platinum. Well, I think this is probably something that is obvious to some of the people that have worked in catalytic reforming, is that if you have sulfate impurities in small amounts in your alumina support, and you happen to put platinum on it, it doesn't matter what you do to it, it's going to end up to be a very poor catalyst for many of the normal metal catalyzed reactions that you do in catalytic reforming. Okay, that's three view graphs I got to bring. And if it does not go against historical convention in these seminars, I would appreciate if you ask the questions as I went along and not wait until yet, because now I'm going to lead the synthesis part of it, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about alkane isomerization in some of these materials. Okay, the first reaction that I'm going to talk about is a normal hexane reaction on the material that I just described the preparation of. And one thing that I can tell you is that the conditions that we work at, 200 degrees Celsius, 780 kPa, total pressure and a ratio 6.5 to 1 of hydrogen to hydrocarbons at 34% conversion, the isomerization selectivity is very, very high. Yes?
What's your sulfate content after a calcine?
That's what it is after a calcine. Yeah. That's it. And it's on a sulfate basis, not a sulfur basis. Well, normal hexane is actually a fairly good molecule to isomerize, and the reason is that most of the acid chemistry of normal hexane does not allow for stable leaving groups in cracking reactions. If you think of hexane, you really cannot form isobutane as a product, because then you're left with a C2 species, and that generally involves a primary carbeniamide, and that's not very stable. Now, as a result of it, you can get very high isomerization selectivity at almost any temperature, including temperatures significantly higher, and there's no problem using platinum or palladium-modified zeolites to do normal hexane isomerization. Now, what is clear is that acid chemistry has some shortcomings. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to tell you something about the isomer ratio that we observe, and the isomer ratio that you would expect if your kinetics were not preventing you from achieving isomerization equilibrium among all the isomers. Well, if you look at the other, let me refer everything to 2-methylpentane just because I need a reference isomer. If you look at the other methyl isomer, the other position of the methyl group, you can see that it's very close to the expected equilibrium value, because methyl shifts are very easy to do in carbeniamide chemistry. All you need to do is shift one of these things from one place to the other one. You're interconverting carbenium ions of equal stability, and it's really an easy reaction to do. And if you do 2,3-dimethylbutane, that's a little bit harder to do. You get slightly less than equilibrium because now you have to bring a methyl group from the end of the molecule and put it somewhere in the middle. The problem that acid chemistry has is that the isomer that we would like the most, because it has the highest octane of any of the dimethyl isomers, is the one that you will not form. And the reason is, imagine having a molecule like this, which you can form fairly easily, and turning it into that one. In order to do that, you have to convert a tertiary carbenium ion, get that methyl group to move, and end up with a secondary one. And acid chemistry, as Hermann Pines showed many, many years ago, has a tremendous problem forming hydrocarbons that have quaternary carbon, and yet those are the ones that we really would like to have. Now, the other issue that I would like to address is why the isomerization selectivity is so high and the cracking selectivity is so low. And it turns out that there is no mechanism, as I pointed out, or not very efficient mechanism, for taking this carbenium ion and doing a beta scission. And the reason is you're left with that C2 fragment. But if you took this molecule and you broke it into C4 and C2, you would expect equal molar amounts of C4 and C2. And yet, if you look at the molar ratio of C4 to C2 in the products of that cracking reaction, the number is about 2.6. And the reason is because it does not have a direct pathway for beta scission. What it must do is build a larger molecule in an oligomerization type reaction, and then crack it into stable fragments. And then you can form isobutane, but only by making this molecule a lot longer. And this is the classical signature or fingerprint of those kind of processes, that you get more of the larger species and a smaller amount of the one that is less stable. So the reason that hexane has high isomerization selectivity is it does not have a direct carbenium ion path for going from an isomer to a cracking product. It turns out things become a lot different when you go the next carbon atom, because now heptane can form isobutane and C3, and actually what happens is you quickly get in trouble, as probably many of you that work in this area already know, when you go to larger molecules. This is the cracking to isomerization ratio at the same conditions, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to increase the size of the arcane one at a time, and then two at a time here. What you find with C5 and C6 is you get almost no cracking. What you find with C7 is you begin to get significant amounts of cracking. What you find when you get to C8, C9, C10, and higher hydrocarbons is that now cracking are your major products, even at fairly low conversion. And they become your predominant product when you push this chemistry down to reasonable industrial conversions of the order of 80 to 90%. So it is very difficult to do isomerization at high conversion and high selectivity with the larger molecules unless you do one or two things. Lower the temperature significantly, which helps, or you introduce an additive to the system that actually inhibits that cracking selectivity. Now, I would like to, and again, for the case of the larger alkanes, you have the same problem with the dimethyl isomers. You can't find them very well, so this is not very interesting for fuels types application. And also, in this particular case, whether you're talking about C7, C8, or C9, by the time you get to this molecule here, which is an isoheptane, there is a simple direct carbenium ion path for giving you isobutane and propane. Because in that case, you're left behind with a secondary carbenium ion, which is reasonably stable. We chose to concentrate on heptane because it was small enough for us to handle and to do some label experiments later on, but also because it allowed in the reactor that we have right now to do online analysis of all the products. And because it has a finite cracking selectivity, and as a result of it, we at least can attempt to inhibit that cracking selectivity in a way that we couldn't do with those two molecules, the cracking selectivities like just involved. Now, where does the cracking come from? Does it come directly from an omaheptane molecule that goes on the surface, or does it occur predominantly by secondary reactions of those isomers? And the way that we decided to look at that was by looking at the effect of conversion, which is changed by varying the bed residence time, in other words, just the flow rate of hydrocarbons at constant conditions. And what you do that, what you find is that the total rate of the reaction does not change. And at this point, I have to tell you that I chose an arbitrary measure of a turnover rate. I decided to express it not in terms of exposed platinum, because I couldn't measure it, but in terms of the number of sulfur atoms that we have in the system. So I have assumed in my calculation, and you can express it per gram or per cc or however you want to do it, I have assumed that this reaction is an acid-catalyzed reaction that depends on the number of sulfur atoms that you have in the system. And then this becomes a turnover rate of very reasonable values of about 3 times 10 to the minus 2 per second. Now, the other thing that is interesting is that as you increase the conversion, the bed residence time, or if you want to look at it a different way, the concentration of primary isomer products in the system, the selectivity to isomerization, or the rate of isomerization in this case, decreases tremendously as you increase the conversion. But it's totally offset by a proportional increase in the cracking rate. So effectively, you're taking molecules from here, and instead of continuing to form them, you're turning them into those cracking products, and this rate is now going up. This says that at least this much of that cracking rate is really because you have taken a gas phase isoheptane that you've already formed and converting it into cracking products. But what it also says is that even when there is no isoheptane in the system, namely at zero conversion, the extrapolated value of that cracking rate is non-zero. So you also get some primary conversion of normal heptane to those cracking products, presumably because you form isoheptane carbenium ions and they have a finite residence time at that surface. And if you don't get them out of that surface fast enough, if you don't desorb them and terminate that carbenium ion, you're going to, in a single surface visit, you're going to crack those carbenium ions to isobutane and propane. Now, we did not have a very good idea as to how this molecule actually finds its way into the gas phase. The question that you have to ask yourself, I think, is how do I terminate this and how does it become a gas phase isoheptane? And what you need to do is you need to provide a source of a hydroxy in order to form a neutral molecule that is no longer interacting with that site and in order to form that gas phase molecule. And let me call that hydride. Let me say that that hydride is present along with another moiety here that will determine the reactivity of that hydride in what is effectively a hydride transfer reaction. And R1 can be several things, and the rest of the talk I think is going to deal mostly with what R1 can be in order to do two things. And the two things that you want to do is increase the total rate. And the faster that you can terminate that carbocation, the higher the turnover rate is going to be. But if you're fortunate, what you're also going to do is you're going to decrease the surface lifetime, because the faster that you can terminate that carbocation, the shorter the average time it will spend in one turnover. Before I do that, I have to tell you a little bit about the conventional mechanism for this kind of chemistry, and there are many, but there are two, I think, that are widely accepted as the two types of pathways that can lead to alkane isomerization in either bifunctional or monofunctional acid catalysts. The first one is the conventional one. Let me call it the conventional one. It is a so-called monomolecular mechanism for activation of alkanes. I don't know why it's called a monomolecular one, but it is. And effectively what you have is you have two functions in the system, one that takes the alkane and does the hydrogen abstraction for you. Once you form those olefins, it's a fairly trivial matter to now take a conventional Brønsted acid and protonate those olefins to give you those carbenium ions. What normally happens in bifunctional catalysts, palladium on zeolite being a classical one, is that there's enough metal around to equilibrate this step. And the rate limiting step is really the reaction of those olefins with the available protons to give you those carbenium ions and those isomeric products. What is the net result of this is that the kinetics of isomerization on bifunctional catalysts are generally negative order in hydrogen. And the reason is this is an equilibrated step which has hydrogen on this side. As you increase the pressure of hydrogen, the equilibrium concentration of those olefins decreases, and therefore your reactant in the second step decreases and the rate goes down. So if you plot the rate versus hydrogen pressure, as you increase the hydrogen pressure, the rate goes down. In contrast, there is a bimolecular chain transfer mechanism which can also terminate one of these carbonium ions by transferring hydrogen from this moiety right here and form that kind of molecule. Don't ask me why it's called a bimolecular chain transfer. Don't ask me why it's called bimolecular, because in my view, these two molecules are generally much too large for a direct bimolecular encounter and a hydride transfer in the gas phase. And what you probably have is a hydride abstraction from this molecule, a hydride addition to that molecule, which is not a concerted reaction. So it's not truly bimolecular, but it's found this nomenclature in the literature so that we will keep it. And in this case, the effect of hydrogen could be different. If this is indeed the rate-limiting step in the chemistry, then we can think of hydrogen, namely H2, as a hydride transfer agent, where R is the other hydrogen atom. And then you can begin to predict that the rate of the overall reaction will actually increase as you increase the concentration of hydrogen. So the next question that we want to answer is, what are the hydrogen kinetics of the system? And they're actually quite unusual when you compare it to platinum and zeolite. This is nothing more than the rate of the reaction that I point out is already being divided by hydrogen pressure. So if the reaction is first order in hydrogen, this should be a straight horizontal line. And that's what we find over the range of pressure that we have looked at. And that range of pressure is between 0.8 and 3 megapascals. Why some of them actually are outliers? The reason is that there is a weak dependence on normoheptane pressure. The pressure order is about 0.2. The rate does increase with heptane pressure, but not very strongly. This is actually quite unusual. Most of these reactions are first order in heptane and negative order in dihydrogen. This one is first order in dihydrogen and almost zero order in heptane. So it's certainly not the conventional one. And it could not possibly be, unless this is a very strange reaction here, a bifunctional type mechanism. So let me propose that it is instead a hydride transfer type mechanism. And what you're doing is you have this carbonium ion sitting around on the surface. And in order for a site to turn over, you have to have a hydride transfer event and a high concentration of this hydride transfer agent. And this is where adamantane came in. Because as we were looking for hydride transfer agents, we thought of several of them. This is one of them. It turns out the product of the reaction is a better hydride transfer agent than the reactant was. But both of them can't be the ones that provide the hydrogen and regenerate a new carbonium ion that can isomerize this system. But when we looked at this species, we said it's going to be very difficult to tell what their effect is, because after all, they're reactants and products of the chemistry. So what is the best hydride transfer that we could come up with that actually was stable at this reaction conditions? And the answer was adamantane. Now, if I increase the concentration of that R1H group that is transferring the hydride, I ought to get two things. The first one is a higher rate of isomerization, and the second one is a shorter residence time at the surface. A shorter residence time at the surface ought to give you a higher probability of capturing an isomer in the gas phase before it does beta scission at the surface. The first one was confirmed what we added adamantane. And don't look at the aromatics one yet. This is the rate of the reaction. Remember, the overall rate of the reaction was independent of conversion. We put only 0.8% adamantane by weight, and the rate of that reaction has increased by about a factor of 2. Not totally unremarkable, but suggesting that we have a hydride transfer mechanism that is at least part of the rate limiting step. The effect of toluene is opposite. If you take a species like an aromatics that generally titrates some of the strongest acid sites by forming some long chain alkyl aromatics in this system, you actually get a removal of some of the acid sites from the manifold and the rate decreases. Now what you've done is you've titrated the strongest acid sites. You have not increased the turnover rate. You have decreased the number of sites available for the chemistry. But yet adamantane, presumably by doing that hydride transfer step and generating a carbonium ion that does not know what to do, because this molecule does not rearrange, does not break carbon-carbon bonds, or has any possible isomerization pathways in this cake structure. It sits around, and it pulls the carbonium ion for the next molecule to come around and regenerate the carbonium ion, replace the hydrogen back on, and go and do it again. So you can look at adamantane as a co-catalyst that somehow increases the rate of the reaction without being consumed itself. And if it's doing this chemistry, it ought to decrease that surface lifetime of that carbonium ion. And if it does that, it ought to increase the selectivity to isomerization. But probably the best way to look at this is to look at what the effect of adamantane concentration is on the chemistry. I looked at the data with 0.8, but it turns out that the effects of adamantane are present even at fairly low concentration. If you look at the total reaction rate, something that was constant and independent of conversion, as you increase the amount of adamantane that you have in the system, the total rate increases. But it increases mostly because of the isomerization rate actually going up, not because the cracking rate is being affected. As a matter of fact, the cracking rate is decreasing at the same time as this isomerization rate is increasing. So what adamantane is doing is most certainly allowing isomerization turnovers to occur faster, and presumably at the same time preventing a secondary reaction in which you form those cracking products. And presumably the way they do it is by losing a tertiary hydrogen here, forming a carbonium ion that cannot do anything except wait for the next molecule to regenerate that adamantane again. The selectivity effects are, I think, more dramatic than the activity effects, and they also suggest this shorter surface lifetime. Now, the problem that you have with selectivity is that it changes with conversion. So in order to be able to compare things on an equal basis, you really have to compare them at the same conversion. And this is what we have done here. If you take normal heptane, this is a selectivity. High cracking selectivity, it increases almost linearly as you increase the concentration of isoheptane products by increasing the conversion of normal heptane. If you add a small amount of aromatics, something that, as we showed before, is an inhibitor of the overall reaction rate, you seem to be titrating some of the strongest bronsted acids and decreasing also the surface lifetime of the carbonium ion. But the effects are rather undramatic. I mean, they're not very significant. But look what happens when you have adamantane in the system. If you bother to look out here at this conversion, you can convince yourself that the selectivity has increased by an order of magnitude. And that's where some of the data that I showed you earlier actually lies. This is a tremendous increase in isomerization selectivity, which actually becomes even more dramatic as you go to larger and larger alkanes. So if you're interested in taking a C20 isomerizing it, adamantane is an even more effective promoter of that chemistry than it is for a fairly small molecule that does not have a very high cracking selectivity. And again, everything that we have seen points out to the fact that if you have this intermediate and you let it sit long enough, you have a very high probability that will ultimately do a beta scission reaction, and that will be the way it chooses to terminate that carbonium ion. But if you give it a mechanism of leaving that dangerous carbonium ion, it will do so, and you will avoid the probability of forming those smaller fragments. Well, if adamantane works, well, first of all, let me show you what the additive effects of adamantane are. It turns out that most of the effects of adamantane, as far as the cracking to isomerization ratio at a given conversion, how we have compared this, are actually obtained with very small amounts of adamantane. Things of the order of 0.1% have given you most of the cracking inhibition that we have seen, and the rest of it does help, but it does not dramatically increase it. So tiny amounts of adamantane, a molecule that is rather abundant in nature, it turns out, will give you a very dramatic effect, a dramatic decrease in the cracking selectivity. The problem is the following. We are interested in making dimethyl and trimethyl isomers. And those are also secondary reactions. Those are also secondary reactions in which, after you form the initial methyl isomer, if you let it sit long enough on the surface, it will do another dimethyl shift. So every time we decrease the surface life time of that intermediate in order to avoid the beta scission reactions, we have also inadvertently decreased the probability that it would form the dimethyl isomer. And indeed, what you find when you add adamantane is that the dimethyl to monomethyl ratio in your product decreases. This is going in the wrong direction for us. So we have solved a problem by decreasing that carbocation surface lifetime, but we have created another one for the specific application that we have. On the other hand, not everybody would like to make dimethyl isomer. In many of the wax hydroisomer work, you actually, one methyl group or two methyl groups are quite enough. In our case, we need isooctane, we need trimethyl pentanes. And this cannot really be done using this kind of chemistry without a significant amount of cracking. So adamantane is not something that solves all of our problems, but I think it gives us at least a handle on what the rate limiting step and the mechanism of that reaction should be. Now, if you accept the fact that this is a rate limiting step that allows for this chain to propagate and generate another one, then you have to ask yourself the question, where should I best put hydrogen in order to be able to do that hydride transfer? And the answer is in adamantane. But it is not the only place that you can put the hydrogen. You can actually put it in one of the reactants or the isoheptane products, and I'm going to show you that that also works. That also increases the rate of the reaction, and that also decreases the cracking selectivity. Or you can do something else. You can put a hydrogen dissociation function, probably platinum sulfide in this case, and use one of the hydrogens to provide the hydride and one of the hydrogens to provide a proton. And if you do that, you can use H2 as a hydride transfer agent. It is not a very good one. Adamantane is better than normal heptane. It is better than hydrogen. But all of them will work provided that you give it a high enough concentration to overcome the low kinetic probability that they have of donating that hydrogen. And it turns out it doesn't matter what you add to the system. And notice that I have done something misleading here. I have plotted the rate of the reaction versus concentration for adamantane increasing with adamantane content. With hydrogen, this is the first order kinetics of the process, increasing with increasing hydrogen pressure. And versus normal heptane, this is the 0.2 kinetic order dependence that we had in normal heptane. What I have done that is misleading is there is a different x-axis for each one of them. And the adamantane goes from 0 to 0.25 kPa, the normal heptane goes from 0 to 250 kPa, and the hydrogen. What I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the hydrogen pressure effect with and without adamantane. This is again the reaction rate. This is the dihydrogen pressure. This is normal heptane, sort of first order kinetics in hydrogen without adamantane, and this is what happens when you have adamantane. Notice two things. If I have enough hydrogen, I don't get an adamantane effect, because I have enough hydrogen to remove the bottleneck at that rate limiting step. On the other hand, if I have adamantane in the system, the hydrogen response is not as great as it was before. If I have enough adamantane, I don't need to rely on hydrogen to do most of the hydride transfer agents. So this suggests that the two of them are doing similar jobs, and the job that I propose that both of them do is to provide the hydride required in order for that chain coming in line to propagate. Well, let me summarize and then field questions and then maybe even discuss with some of the people that are actually interested in the area some of the deuterium exchange work that we're beginning to do with some of the materials. This is not our discovery. It's been around for a while. I think there's been some controversy as to whether you require a metal. I don't think you require a metal, but you need at least a metal cation that can dissociate hydrogen, and that may be what platinum sulfide or sulfur covered platinum is actually doing. Do you need dihydrogen? In our hands, you need both platinum and dihydrogen in order to be able to do this truly catalytic. C7 alkanes, there is no industrial practice of C7 plus deep isomerization of alkanes, because cracking is a predominant competing reaction. You cannot get your isomers fast enough before they continue to crash. In that sense, the ability to remove the bottleneck that we believe we have and the ability to extract those carbonium ions faster by putting adamantane or higher pressures of hydrogen or higher pressures of normal heptane will increase the isomerization rate, but more dramatically, I think, increase the selectivity by inhibiting those cracking pathways. If you go to higher hydrogen pressure, the cracking selectivity goes down. This is against everything that I was taught in graduate school, that whenever you increase the availability of hydrogen on a surface, you always get more hydrogenolysis. Yet for this system, as you increase the hydrogen pressure, you actually get a decrease in the cracking step, because what hydrogen is doing is allowing you to leave with your true primary products before they get a chance to convert to the secondary. Now, this faster hydride transfer steps obviously will increase the rate because you can desorb the products, and once you desorb the products, you have your site again to do some more chemistry. So the turnover time is much smaller, and the residence time of those dangerous intermediate that would like to crack if you're leaving them long enough are much lower. And as a result, you end up with much lower selectivity. Now, many things can transfer hydrogen, and some are better than others, and the better they are, the lower the concentration that you need, the worse they are, the higher the concentration that you need. The last thing that you ought to think about is what 0.1% adamantane really does for you and what it costs you to do it. I'd like to leave you with the following thought. There's no reason why you cannot take adamantane and graft it onto sulfate of zirconium and have your hydride transfer co-catalyst be truly heterogeneous and attached to that surface. I will leave you on the unhappy note to tell you that we have not been able to do that. And the reason is this adamantane molecule will like to go on the surface with this valuable hydrogen down on the surface. So it dissociates the easiest to dissociate hydrogen, and you lose all hydrogen transfer probability. But there must be ways of functionalizing that adamantane that would allow you to graft it through the bottom, through the cyclohexane ring, and actually have it nearby with the rest of the catalytic entities that you have in the system. If any of you have any ideas, I would love to hear about it. Thank you.
Does the reaction go without the platinum at all?
It goes, but it doesn't turn over. You may get at most one turnover. If you think of sulfate of zirconia as having Lewis acid sites and Bronsted acid sites, you can envision an alkane coming down and actually using the Lewis site to accept the hydride and the Bronsted site to accept the carbonium ion. But then the question becomes, if this is a good Lewis acid site, it's not going to give up that hydride. And the question is, after you isomerize that carbonium ion, how do you get it off the surface? And the fact is that in the absence of hydrogen and a hydrogen dissociation agent, or in the absence of an alkane that can transfer hydrogen much more readily than heptane or isoheptane, you have a problem turning over that site, even though you may be able to form a very stable carbonium ion. You can't get it off after you form it. So we can't get any more than one turnover on any one of those catalysts. We can see some products, but for a very short period of time. Yet the Japanese work and some work by Pareto's group suggests that you can do these things in the absence of other things. We can't do it.
Have you tried molybdenum or tungsten on it?
No, but that's a good point. I think people have tried things like nickel and palladium, and they don't work very well. But then palladium sulfides and nickel sulfides are actually not very good at dissociating hydrogen, whereas molybdenum sulfides and maybe tungsten sulfides and cobalt sulfides may very well.
But people, some use
iron,
manganese
sulfate. I just read the work about 2 weeks ago, and it is unclear to me that they truly have a more acidic catalyst. I think they may very well have a catalyst where they have inadvertently incorporated an iron sulfide function that is doing some of the hydrogen transfer that normally platinum would have to do. If you compare the activity of those catalysts with this one, it's not that different. But if you compare it to the activity of oncomoid sulfate of zirconium, which is their claim, yes, they are two orders of magnitude higher.
making you comfortable for the formation of a carbon dioxide by radical magnetism instead of carbon catalyst? Because based on your data, when you add toluene, toluene is well known as the radical inhibitor. So
yeah,
it decreases the beta season of your radical.
Yeah,
but
well,
when you add and maintain, which promotes the carbocatalyst reaction,
mm-hmm,
that's why decrease the cracking production.
Yeah. Well, first of all, if you notice the temperature that we're operating at is about 200 degrees Celsius, there's very little in the way of thermochemistry that goes on at those temperatures on these materials. Toluene is also a well-known inhibitor of acid sites. And the way it presumably works is by attaching itself to an existing carbenium ion, and in this case forming an alkyl aromatics, which is an extremely stable carbenium ion, and would like to do nothing more than to sit there. And it usually goes to the strongest binding sites, okay, which are the ones that have the longest residence time of carbocations. So the selectivity effect of toluene is also consistent with the fact that you have decreased the strength of the average site that is left available to do this chemistry. There's a lot of work that has been done to suggest that radical cations are actually the intermediates in higher temperature isomerization and carbenium ion chemistry. I don't think anybody would dare propose a radical at 200 degrees Celsius. At least they haven't.
If you look at the competitive absorption of radical what prevents the methyl isomer from reabsorbing, and so at least competitively with heptane,
no,
and to wash out the nice selectivity you get from the surface?
Nothing, except that the two effects are additive. First of all, you have an initial probability of even getting up the surface as isoheptane, and that is what adamantane improves for. If you look at the data on the effect of adamantane, the slopes have not changed. Adamantane does not change the probability that isoheptane will come back and crack again. What it does is it gives you a chance of getting it off the surface first without cracking it. So it's an intercept with the y-axis that is decreased by adamantane. There's very little that you can do because, as you point out, isoheptane will compete with everything else. It's a matter of concentrations. And it's a damn good hydride transfer agent. That's why it likes to go back and crack. And as you get larger, it gets worse.
Wait a minute, how does it first and then sulfate?
Right.
How about reverse?
If we do it in the reverse, we can get almost the same thing. In our hands, it's a little worse than doing it this way. In both cases, we apparently get totally covered platinum, so we don't see platinum type behavior either way. We never did it this way until towards the end of the program because we thought, well, we're going to cover the platinum with sulfate if we put it after the platinum. But the fact is that the sulfur finds the platinum regardless of how you put it there. So we find no benefit of doing it that way. We have found higher activities using this procedure than the other one, but I have to admit we have no idea why, and that's still What I'm telling you is that once you find a good catalyst, you can do an awful lot of good mechanistic studies, but finding a good catalyst is not an easy thing to do with this system. So now at least we can do it reproducibly, and that's not producible. So mechanistic studies.
Well, for one who's gone through the ordeal four times in a day and a half, again, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.